You got us? On the right foot tonight. You've got a crowd here that is, you know, here to see just how good this men's team is. And is it good enough to make the time commitment to come here game after game, week after week? And so it really is an opportunity for this basketball team to show these fans just how exciting it can be when the men's team plays here in the Bob Carpenter Center.
Like we said, one of two chances before the calendar turns to see Delaware at home. Hopefully we'll have more fans rolling in to this one. Let's get to the starting lineup. It's brought to you by National 5 and 10 on Main Street. It's the place to buy all your University of Delaware souvenirs and clothing online at National5and10.com. For Charleston Southern, the Buccaneers will go with a lineup of two guards, two forwards, and two centers. A traditional lineup as opposed to Delaware's four-guard offense. Son Ibley, Matt Kennedy are the guards. Malcolm Bernard and Paul Gombwer are the forwards. And Ali Fula is the center for Delaware. They've got four guards on offense. Usher, Threet, Sadler, Anderson. Carl Baptiste is the jumper in the middle. He will jump with Fula. The officials, Carl Hess, Joe Lindsay, and Sean Hull. And the ball is tipped. Delaware going left to right wearing the home white uniforms. First time we see these new white and blue uniforms for Delaware. New jerseys this year for home and road games. They got the basketball first. Head coach Monte Ross for Delaware. Head coach Barclay Radenbaugh in his ninth season with Charleston Southern. Threet with the basketball outside left on Delaware's first possession of the afternoon. Usher, jab step, guarded closely. Passes back out. Delaware patient on offense on the opening set. 16 to shoot now for Sadler, guarded by the smaller Son Imlet. Now it's Threet, driving into the paint, kicks out Anderson, thought about a three, glides through the lane, kicks out to Usher. He'll take the triple, front rim no. Baptiste with the putback, and Delaware starts off the offense 2-0.
Well, that's a nice rebound by Baptiste. He didn't hesitate, went right in and tapped it in. So a nice job by him. That's what Ross wants to see early on from his big man in the middle.
Baptiste had the first points of the game on Friday night as well as Nimley gets across the lane and goes to Kennedy. Kennedy a miscommunication with his teammate Bernard, and the first turnover of the day for Charleston Southern gives it right back to Delaware.
Well, Anderson has been given the task of guarding Nimley at least to start, so we'll see how he's able to move. As we mentioned in the pregame show, there's going to have to be a lot of team defense with this new hand checking move.
Usher with it on the right side. It's three. As the guards work the ball around the perimeter, four guards on offense. We'll see this starting lineup a lot this year. Carl Baptiste inside. Good entry pass by Usher, and Baptiste with the first four.
Well, already you can see Baptiste is taking advantage of the 2 inches he has on the next tallest guy on the floor, and so a nice job by the Delaware offense getting it inside.
And now Charleston Southern goes inside. Fuller working on Baptiste. Good defense by Carl Baptiste. Passing out Nimley. Gets three in the air. Steps in a lane. Foots one off the window, and the kiss is through for Nimley. His first points.
Yeah, it's going to be a tough shot to stop if he can make that.
4-2, Delaware's lead. Minute 45 into the game. Three driving on Kennedy. Loses dribble. Corner. Anderson spots up. Fires and hits.
Well, that's huge for Delaware if Anderson can get on target early.
Nimley wants three right back, rattles out, and Devon Sadler, a rebound for the guards. He's pushing across half court quickly. Behind the back, Sadler switches hands, and the right-handed layup goes down. Delaware up 9-2 early.
And we saw that big smile at Devon Sadler early when that move. What a great move that was to the basket. Behind the back pass, he split the defense and went right to the hoop and made a nice touch layup.
17-41, first half, Hens up by seven. Nimley, the only scorer for Charleston Southern. Three guys on the board for the Hens and Kennedy. Driving baseline, blocking foul going to be called against Devon Sadler. That's his first and the team's first.
Yeah, and that blocking foul by Sadler is not a result of the new hand-checking rule. That was going to be a block at any point of any season. So, but it was it's not a bad foul if he doesn't pick up a lot of them this first half.
Kennedy will inbound. Left side of the basket, throwing into his center, Fuller. He's looking for a guard, and he gets it out to Gomber, his first touch offensively, and Nimley from NBA range hits it.
Wow.
Nimley already showing an impressive array of talents, scored on the inside and then takes it deep. He had 77 threes a season ago, makes one there.
Yeah, he's going to have to make sure Anderson's got to get out on him and get a hand in his face. He's a few inches taller, so should be able to stop him from getting at least a free open look.
9-5 is the count. Delaware on top by four. Three top of the key. Guarded by Kennedy. Crossover. Pull up. Jay from the foul line. Strong. Tipped by Baptiste. And out of bounds it goes. It'll be Charleston Southern basketball with 17 minutes left in the first. We see the first substitutions of the day and our first look this season. Anyone's first look at Arlen Harper, who did not play Friday night for Charleston Southern. He checks it, as does Cedric Bowen, the team's leading scorer on their opening night. And Sheldon Strickland, the senior from Georgia, comes in. They're joined by Nimbley and Gombor, the two starters left on the floor.
Well, we'll see if Harper, we're not sure what his injury was, but we'll see if it affects him at all early on here.
Nimbley crossing over on Usher, lobs it up, alley-oop is completed from Nimbley to the newly inserted Cedric Bowen, and it's 9-7 now. Delaware on top by two.
Well, that worked because Nimbley had that kiss off the glass earlier. That's what they thought it was going to be, and Baptiste defended that, not the alley-oop pass.
Sadler on top, over to Usher. Usher holds, takes a couple dribbles inside the three. Extra pass, Anderson, and Anderson is two of two. Hens up 12-7.
Well, we knew he's a better shooter than the 2 of 6 he was at Richmond, and you can see the advantages of being at home. 2 for 2 and nothing but net on both.
Beautiful ball movement, too, to set him up, and some good ball movement there for the second straight time for Charleston Southern. It's Harper making his impact felt. A dish off to the big man, Gombler, and it's 12-9.
Well, he didn't look hurt on that play, that's for sure.
Three. Has the basketball for Delaware, spinning across two defenders in the lane, and he draws the contact and the foul. Jarvis Street led to the free throw line. First foul called on Charleston Southern. What a move by Jarvis.
Yeah, and that's what he does, and he does it well. And, you know, he has the ability to pull up and make a jumper like he did in one of the previous possessions, but when he doesn't and he can get to the basket, 9 times out of 10, he gets a shot up, and he often either makes it or gets fouled.
Street at the free throw line where he ended his last game against Richmond with two misses, unfortunately, when the score tied 69 apiece. He could not come up with one from the line, but he makes his first there. He was 12 of 17 against Richmond. You can get used to seeing 12, 13, 14 free throws per game for Jarvis Street. He's going to get to the line.
And he did last year. He'll get there even more this year with that new hand-checking rule.
Foul was on Bowen. Shot clock does not start after the made basket, so a timeout on the floor is 16:02. We'll stay right here. That was the first foul on Bowen. And Jarvis Street goes 2 of 2 from the line, 14-9 early on in this one. Nimbley with 5 points. And Anderson with 6 to lead with scores.
Well, Monte Ross has to be happy. You know, you always wonder how your team is going to rebound after a very tough loss. You know, of course, as the coaches will tell you and the players will tell you, we shook it off, we're moving on. But, you know, the home opener, everybody's a little bit nervous. And, you know, you just never know how you're going to react to the big crowd here. And, you know, so fortunately they've come out. And now I think the key is going to be to keep Charleston Southern from going on a run of their own. And because what you don't want to do, you got a five-point lead early. You don't want to go into a funk like happened in Richmond and allow Charleston Southern to come back and even take a lead. So it's going to be important here for this Delaware defense especially to maintain its poise and not give up easy baskets and let Charleston Southern get back in it.
14-9. Still early here. I would say Charleston Southern's in it right now.
Yeah, you're right.
Harper inside to Bowen, foul. Oh, they're going to call him for a traveling violation as he bobbled the basketball and turns it over again for Charleston Southern, the third for the Bucks. We'll take time out here with 15:49 remaining in the first half. Hens up 14-9 off two threes from Kyle Anderson. Back in a moment.
They've shot a few threes, and so they've done a very good job of getting the entire offense in early on here.
Usher with it as we get back in action after the turnover by Charleston Southern sent us to break. Now it's Sather. He'll pull up, try to get the three-point action, rims out, rebounded by Baptiste. Good O-Rev, double team, and he fights through everybody to put it back up and through. He's got six of Delaware's 16.
Well, that's one of those. It wasn't a really long rebound, but it wasn't one that came just off the front of the rim, and he had to chase it, and he did it, and that was crucial in that tip back.
Nimbly from Wilmington can't connect off the front rim. Baptiste baseball pass intercepted by Arlen Harper at half court. Now he gets inside the lane, gliding to the rim and scoring, taking on two defenders and winning that battle. Charleston Southern in double figures, 16-11.
Yeah, Baptiste has to stop that pass in the possession.
And now Saller slicing through inside. Quick offense for Delaware, 18-11 is their lead.
Yeah, there's got to be a balance between when you push the ball, which was good on that one, and when it's time to just hold it back and let your guards take it up the floor.
Saw an opening there and took it. Sadler's got four. Now Gombler working inside on Usher. There's a mismatch with Usher as the power forward, a guard playing in the four spot, and Gombler, a true power forward, getting the best of it, 6'6", 215.
Yeah, nice job by Charleston making that play happen.
18-13, Delaware up five. Anderson's third three on the way. This time short, back tap by Baptiste, and Sadler grabs it near the sideline at half court. Nice team effort on that rebound.
Yeah, Baptiste did a nice job there tapping it away, and even if his teammate didn't get it, the worst was going to happen is it was going to go out of bounds.
It's Anderson top of the key. He was calling for it earlier in this possession after missing from the corner. They're going to run him off some screens and see if they can find him on the right side. Usher with it inside of Baptiste. Baptiste spinning. Soft touch around and out. Jarvis tips it, and a whistle is going to be called on the rebound against Jarvis Street, reaching over his defender. His first, team second.
Yeah, he swung his arm a little bit, and anytime you swing your arm like that, you know, no matter how hard you hit the guy, the ref's usually going to make the call.
We'll see Matt Kennedy come back in. Saw Nimbley to the bench. Nimbley 5 points on 1 of 3 from three-point range, 2 of 4 from the field, and an assist, but he'll take a breather. Sheldon Strickland now the point guard, bring the ball up the floor, named the 2009-10 Big South All-Freshman team a few years back. Saunders in the game as well. Gets it to Kennedy after his first touch. Kennedy left to right, stop, floats in the lane. A nice touch by Matt Kennedy from 3 feet out.
Yeah, there's not much more Anderson can do on that play. He played good defense. Kennedy just pulled up and got it over top of him.
Now it's Usher with Marvin King Davis into the ballgame for the first time after the stoppage. Three toying with Kennedy, a couple behind-the-back dribbles. Now a pass to Davon Usher, and he misses from three. 1 of 8 now as a bluehead is Usher, but a big one on Friday night was the make. Now Strickland down the floor, shot blocked by Marvin King Davis. Offensive rebound for Charleston Southern, and a putback for Fullah makes the score 18-15. Delaware on top, just three.
Yeah, King Davis couldn't do much defensively there because he was in out of position. Once the rebound came down, he had to keep those hands up. That's what Rafferty says they've been teaching him with this new rule. Show the ref your hands.
Charleston Southern, 8 of 11 now from the field. Two of those misses on threes from Nimbley. Now a pass intercepted across court. Harper, an easy pass to lane. And that gives Charleston Southern their first lead, 19-18, taking advantage of a miscue on a pass.
Yeah, and this is the momentum change we talked about. We didn't want to see Delaware give up that early momentum, and they have now. And so it's going to be important that they continue to fight like they did in Richmond.
12:35, first half. Delaware working the ball around the perimeter. A wide open Davon Usher can't connect from the corner, but a foul away for the ball as Sadler was held onto by Sheldon Strickland. First on Strickland, second on the team.
Well, we were talking before we went on the air, Scott, the importance of the guards for this University of Delaware team having to get rebounds on both ends of the court. And I've liked what I've seen so far. Sadler there, fouled when he was fighting for a rebound. Threat picked up a foul, fighting for the rebound. And so, you know, the guards are going to have to get in there and be scrappy if they're going to get some rebounds, because Batista is the biggest kid on the floor, and it's going to be that way a lot this season for the Hens.
We see Usher head to the bench after the whistle. Marvin King Davis and Devon Pinkard join the starters, Anderson, Sadler, and Threat. Now another foul away from the ball as Delaware was posting up on offense, and that's the third against Charleston Southern. I believe against Fullah, that would be his first.
Well, like you said in the pregame, we're going to see a lot of fouls if the refs call it like they're supposed to do, and we're seeing that early on here already.
Delaware going to reset shot clock at 12:20 left in the first half. Pinkard played well in his debut against Richmond. A lot of talent for the freshman. We're number 11 from Lancaster, Pennsylvania. He has the basketball now, looking for a teammate, and it's Sadler. Sadler, 6 points, 3 rebounds. Working on Kennedy, now over to Threat. On the wing, right side, above the three-point arc. It's Anderson, thought about Threat, driving inside, getting to the rim, but ball poked out. It'll stay with Delaware, 15 to shoot after the inbound. But 11:59 on the first half clock will send us to a timeout. Delaware was leading, now they trail, 19-18. Plenty of basketball left, 11:59 left in the first half.
Shot here.
And now goes to MKD out to Pinkard on the wing right side. Three collects. He's got 10 to work with. Guarded by Kennedy on top right. Seven to shoot now as he gets in the lane. Gliding using the left. Can't finish off the window. Grabs his own offensive rebound. Goes up strong with it. Missed. Tipped out. Nimbley has it for Charleston Southern. Racing across half court. He's got 4-on-2. Saunders will pull up for the three. And that's smooth for Charleston Southern. Their largest lead, 22-18.
Well, Monte Ross told us that transition defense was going to be a key. And that time it bit the Hens in the butt. They didn't get back fast enough. And Charleston was able to pull it out and pull up for a three.
Three down the right side. That's Will Saunders, a JUCO transfer. And you were saying Rainball thinks he's the top shooter he's ever recruited.
Yeah, yep.
Step back Sadler, not a bad shooting recruit, but can't connect on that try. Nimbley ahead, running down the floor. Finds a man, it's Bernard. And now that's what Coach Ross talked about us before. And got to stop that transition basketball. Not able to do so there. 24-18, Charleston Southern continues to build a lead. Inside, Marvin King Davis underneath, can't finish at the rim, gets his own rebound, power dribble up again and missing, tipped by Pinkard, ball out and a rebound by Charleston Southern. That's twice Delaware in the last three possessions, unable to score at the basket.
Yeah, and if you're going to get the offensive rebounds in tight, you either got to go up and make it or you got to get fouled. So you got to look for, be able to see them. Once they're inside, they're getting good position, they're just not converting the layups afterwards.
Now it's Nimbley finally settling the Charleston Southern offense that's been running rather quickly in the first part of this first half. 10:30 left to play in half number one. Nimbley touched by MKD and his pass deflected. Gets to Kennedy with six to shoot. Kennedy with five now. Drives on three, an offensive foul. Nice job by three to draw the foul on Kennedy. He saw the arm extended and backed off in three. That's all defense getting that call.
Yeah, the referee was right in front of it, so it was an easy call for him. And as you said, Sedale moved his feet quickly, and he was able to get himself in position to make that happen.
First on Kennedy, fourth on Charleston Southern. We'll see some substitutions as Baptiste and Usher come back in. King Davis and Anderson to the bench. Anderson's first rest of the afternoon. Three to cross half court, gets over to Usher and Pinker. A good three-point shooter, had the ball at three-point range, passed it out. Now it's Jarvis in traffic. The teardrop falls from about 10, left side.
Yeah, Jarvis Street is looking at the ref. He wants a foul, and the ref kind of gave him the look like, you don't need to talk to me about that again. He's done that the last two times he's put a shot up.
24-20 now is the count. Harper trying to change that with a three, and he does. Knocked down on the triple. Harper had 53 of those a season ago. Gets his first in the 2013-14 campaign. It's now 27-20.
Well, Harper's 3-for-3 from the field, so it obviously isn't his right shoulder that's bothering him because he's having no trouble scoring so far tonight once he got into the game.
Someone should tell the scoreboard operator that was a... There we go. Now they've got 27-20 up. They've been a little slow on the baskets, and I believe that's what the pause is there.
It's their home opener, too.
That's right. Everybody's home opener. In fact, the shot clock operator a little slow for the second time today. Now a pause in the action as 32 on the shot clock as we resume play. There was a pause originally because the shot was so smooth off the hand of Harper. It had the net fly back up on top of the rim and get stuck. So they had to fix that. Now we're ready to go, and Jarvis Street gets the inbound pass from Pinker. Hens trailing by seven. They had a seven-point lead of their own, 9-2, early stages of this one. 9:34 now, first half, and Usher has the basketball to Sadler. Sadler at the foul line, guarded by Harper, and some body contact offensive foul going against Devon. That's number two on the reigning CAA Player of the Year runner-up a season ago.
Well, there's a little bit of talking going on here, and Usher's got to watch himself. He almost got a technical, and you know it went both ways. There was a little taunting by Harper with the hand clap after the offensive foul, but Usher went right up to him and said something to him, and nice job by the ref jumping in and getting it settled right down. I don't think it warranted a technical, but they're going to be watching now for sure, so Usher has to get settled down. Might not be the worst idea for Ross maybe to call him over and talk to him.
And a nice job by Usher to calmly speak with the officials, and everything's ready to go. But Sadler going to sit for the first time this season after picking up his second. Leaves Kennedy open in the corner, and Charleston Southern knocks down another three. They're up 30-20 after making it rain for three-point range. They're now 13-16 from the field. Amazing.
Yeah, that's an adjustment Delaware's going to have to make.
Yeah, Saunders called for the block on Usher's drive, his first and the team's fifth. That foul by Sadler was the team's third. So with 9:01 left in the first half, the Hens find themselves trailing by 10 points, and the Charleston Southern team shooting 4 of 6 from three-point distance.
Well, and with Sadler out now, we'll see if Usher doesn't try to get himself a shot. You know, he came into Delaware, says he's an unselfish player, which I believe, no reason to think so, but he's also coming in with an 18-point average, so we know he can score.
after the inbound. 30 seconds on the shot clock. It was reset after the foul. Three has the basketball. Driving, kicking out to Usher. Usher the lefty. Over to Anderson. Anderson fires away from three. Cannot connect and rebounded by Arlen Harper for Charleston Southern. Pushing ahead. Charleston Southern loves to run. Kick out Kennedy. Extra pass Saunders for three again. And Delaware needs to sit down. They will.
Yeah.
Charleston Southern cannot miss right now. 5 of 7 from triple. That's 1 of 3 from Nimbley. And Nimbley missed the first two. Yeah. So they've been hot since then. Harper's got one, Saunders has two, and Matt Kennedy has one as well. This is a three-point shooting squad.
Well, you know what makes this even more impressive, Scott, is the gym that they play in at home is like a high school gymnasium. And so, you know, we always talk about when the high school teams here in Delaware come into the Bob Carpenter Center and to do the semifinals and the state championship, it's a tough depth perception adjustment because there's no wall behind the two baskets like there are in the gymnasium. And so, you know, the fact that they've come in here and fired away like they have for threes, you know, that just tells you what a good three-point shooting team they are, because, you know, they're not letting this crowd, they're not letting the depth perception or anything else bother them. They're just firing away, and a lot of the threes are open, and so that's going to be a defensive adjustment that Delaware is going to have to make.
And Delaware, a team that shot 31% from three a season ago, 4 of 21 from three against Richmond, and they start 2 of 8 today. Those two makes off the hands of Kyle Anderson, who knocked down his first two but has missed his next two attempts. He's got the basketball now, does Anderson. Inside to Baptiste, left block, cutting is Usher. Usher turns, fires to Pinkard. He can't hold on. Turnover by Delaware. Charleston Southern has it back, up 13 points coming off of Amante Ross' 32nd timeout. Now Kennedy to the lane, misses, but a putback slam by Cedric Bowen using two, and it's a 15-point lead.
Well, that was a great job by Bowen. Nobody boxed him out, and he just leaped over everybody.
Usher for three. That's short side of the rim, and Charleston Southern wants to run again. It's Nimbley this time. Kennedy in the corner. Thought about the three instead. Drives on Anderson at the left block. Kicks it out to Nimbley. Nimbley from way downtown.
Wow.
Boom. Wow. Oh. 18 points is the lead for Charleston Southern. They are 16 of 20. From the field.
Wow, and you know, very similar to what they did the other night against Johnson when they shot 83% in the first half.
Pinkard for three, he misses. Usher crashes but can't hold on. Baptiste drives to the floor, ball out of bounds. Usher giving his best effort, but it goes to Charleston Southern. I'm starting to think that Johnson, the team that they beat 130-51, might be a top team in the country.
Yeah.
Charleston Southern's just that good. We'll find out if it can last, but right now it's been all Bucks, 38-20. We'll take the timeout with 7:29 left to go in the first half. To 20
And for those people listening, Nimley is 5'8" and nailing them.
Usher off the window. It's a Duncan shot from about 15. Found the angle and gets Delaware in the books the first time in a while. Now Nimbley gets three in the air and draws the foul. If you don't make the three, you get three free throws out of it. Every possession, Charleston Southern is adding to their total. They are 17 of 21 from the field, 7 of 9 now from three. And Nimbley, a three-point foul on three. That's a second on Jarvis and the fourth on the team.
Well, what that is a result of Nimbley making those three other three-pointers, because you got to go out and cover them, and if you're not on top of them, you're going to have to jump at them, and that's exactly what three did, and Nimbley got them up in the air, and then it's an easy call for the referee.
Nimbley makes the first, knocks down the second, a 76% free throw shooter a season ago, made 77 threes last year, attempted 235 of them. Only Carl Cochran of Wofford, who was a sophomore, shot more threes as an underclassman in the nation a year ago. They are doubling up Delaware right now, 44 to 22.
Delaware needs to score. Doesn't matter from where or who does it.
Usher, right elbow. He's going to try to do it himself, missing early in the shot clock. And Nimbley, the 5'8 guard, with the rebound. He kicks out. Bernard inside, and Usher gets the steal. He's racing down the floor. Inside. Wow. Nice take by Davon. And a layup is through on the right side. 24 points for Delaware. They trail by 20.
Yeah, heading in on the right. I wasn't sure he was going to be able to get that left-handed layup off, but he did. A very nice move inside. And there you can see why he averaged 18 points per game last year.
He's got four today. Delaware in trouble in the first half, though. 6 minutes left. They got to make a run before going into the locker room. As Bernard challenges Baptiste, and good D by Carl, adjusts the shot, and Sadler gets a defensive rebound. He goes down the floor quickly. Now it's Jarvis three. He'll try up with three, and that's short, long rebound. Baptiste in the right spot at the foul line, and he collects for Delaware. Now Sadler will for a triple, and he knocks it down. Delaware has five straight, and it's 44-27. Bucks.
Another offensive rebound for Baptiste. We talked about the importance of him rebounding in these games because he's the only big guy on the floor, technically the only guy who's not a guard. So nice job by him getting to the offensive glass.
Nimbley on the drive, and a foul called against Jarvis three. That's the third on Jarvis. He'll have to take a break for a while. Devon Pinkert will come into this one. Jarvis finished the game with four fouls against Richmond, so he's having a tough time adjusting to the point of emphasis this season. That's the fifth on the team. Sadler has the other two.
Well, and the good thing is he's got a chance to adjust before the CAA games start. And, you know, we talked about the importance of it being consistent throughout the entire season, and that's going to be critical because, you know, Threet's a smart player. He's figuring out now what he's going to be allowed to do and not to do, and so hopefully it maintains that when it does get the conference play.
5-12 first half. Hens on a 5-0 run, but Charleston Southern up 44-27. Here at the bottom for the home opener. Strickland in the corner, a crossover by Gombler. Now back in the corner goes Strickland, and Strickland hand in the face, and a three is down. 8 of 10. They're shooting 80% from three, unheard of. To start this game, the Hens go back down 20.
Yeah, it really is incredible. We talked about how they shot 83% from the field in their first game, but to be 80% from the three-point line is just unbelievable.
Baptiste, mid-right block. It's Pinkert on top. Usher. Hand off to Sadler. Sadler crossover on Kennedy. Step back, jumper, Sadler, smooth. He's got five straight for the Hens, and they cut it to 47-29.
Well, we talked in the pregame how Sadler Reed on the bench now. It might be that time.
Gomber inside to Fula. He's fouled by Baptiste, and even 3 points available from inside the paint as that one goes through, and a foul shot coming up. He can get a three-point play the old-fashioned way. After the foul by Carl, his first team six.
Well, I'm not sure there's a whole lot more Baptiste could have done there. He slid with his body, had his hands up in the air, but there was some chest-to-chest contact, and unfortunately the ref was right at the angle where he could see that contact. My guess is if the ref was standing behind Baptiste, he probably wouldn't have called it because his hands were up in the air. But, you know, so kind of just bad luck for Baptiste on the angle there. Definitely was a foul, should have been called, but it was just a tough angle for the ref to be in there and saw it perfectly, and that's why it was called.
Fula makes the basket, and it's 50-29. As I gotta talk to the scoreboard operator. It's a little slow on the trigger today. Pinkert with the basketball. He'll fire away from three, and wow. Devon Pinkert, the freshman, helping things out. 50-32 now is Delaware's deficit to the Bucs.
Well, fans are going to get to see a lot of Pinkert over the next 4 years, so that was a great shot by him, a shot the Hens needed.
Kennedy at the foul line, fading. It's short, good rebound by Davon Usher. He's pushing. It's 3-on-2. Behind the back, to the rim, Davon Usher. What a play, and the Hens have 5 in a row.
Well, we've seen two behind-the-back moves, one by Sather and one from Usher, and both worked out.
50-34 is the Charleston Southern advantage. Foulon shakes right, shoots left, and rebounded by Usher after the miss.
Well, that move by Usher the last time down was one I could try for 5 times and not get it.
Sather pulls up. He hits 7-0 run for Delaware. And it's now 50-36. And Barclay Radenball wants to talk to his squad. Delaware showing some signs of life on offense. They trail by 14, but looking good the last 3 trips down.
Well, and we knew that it was going to be Sather and that it was going to be Usher who were going to be the potential to be the big-time scorers for this team. They both talked about him. You know, when anybody that talked to him or interviewed him before the season, two big scorers, how are you guys going to share the ball? And they both were very adamant that they were here for one reason, to play together, and that is to win basketball games. They played on the same AAU circuit down growing up in the Baltimore area, so they were familiar with each other. And so Sather was thrilled to have Usher come up here. Monte Ross has stressed several times he's a great teammate. He's not just a great player. And what you've seen the last few times down the floor is the potential of both these guys to not only be scorers, but to be exciting scorers.
Looking at the box, Sather already in double figures. He's got 11. 6 points for Usher, Baptiste, and Anderson. 4 for 3. He'll sit for a while with the 3 fouls. Pinkert with 3. Devon Pinkert, the freshman, standing 6'6", averaged 18 points per game a season ago at J.P. McCaskey High School. Received offers from the Citadel, East Carolina, UMBC. We're glad he chose to come to Newark because, as John shared, he's going to have a long career here at Delaware, getting most of the freshman rotation minutes. He and Barnett Harris played on Friday night against Richmond. We saw Kasman Hayes in for just a moment on Friday night, but Pinkert, the only freshman in the true, I guess, first 7 or 8 of rotation. 50-36, back in action after the timeout taken by Radenball. A 3 from Saunders, and they just can't miss. I don't know if I've ever seen anything like it. 9 of 11 from 3, and they've made their last 7 from 3-point range.
Yeah, and Usher got over there, got a hand in his face, and he still drained it.
Will Saunders makes it 53-36. Delaware with 3 minutes left in the first half, as it was Sather over to Usher. Usher driving on nimbly to Anderson now. Anderson back to Devon. Devon's had the hot hand. Can it continue from 3? It does. Devon Sather a triple, making it 53-39. Now running the floor is Bowen. He beat everyone down the court. And 2 right back for Charleston Southern. 55-39 is the count of this high scoring, high paced first half.
Yeah, transition defense critical. Monte Ross said it. We've talked about it already. They've got to get back on defense against this team.
Now Usher for 3. Things heating up in Newark. He knocks it down, and the Hens within 13. It's 55-42.
Devon and Davon. That could be the 1-2 punch this year.
Nimbly in the paint. Kick out. Saunders. Saunders extra pass. Kennedy. Another 3 is good for Charleston Southern. They're going to run out of t-shirts here, tossing things around every time a triple is made. 6 for Delaware. 10 of 12 for Charleston Southern. Unbelievable showcase of shooting here in the first half. We'll take a break with 2:15 remaining. 61-42 the count. Charleston Southern on top.
I thought it was. Yeah, I thought that 3 made it 61. Maybe.
Back at the Bob Carpenter Center, where a three-point barrage has Charleston Southern up 58-42. This is a team that knows how to knock down threes, not only in their conference, but around the nation. They were one of the tops this season ago, Jeff.
Yeah, you know, when I was looking at some of the numbers they had, I was impressed that they were ranked 39th in entire Division I nationally in scoring. And then another number came up, and I actually thought it was a misprint. They are second in the entire country in made three-pointers per game last year. So while this might be new to you and me and the fans here at the Bob Carpenter Center, it's nothing new to Charleston Southern.
And another delay as we have the timeout here, and 33 on the shot clock. 58-42 is the score showing on the scoreboard. It was 61-42 as we went to break. And some troubles with the scoreboard, some trouble with the shot clock operator. Everybody's home opener, I guess, today. But they got to clean that this up here at the Bob as the score did change. Now the official talking with Sports Information Director Scott Selheimer to kind of check the book,
right,
if you
that's
will.
That's what you get to now, yeah.
That's kind of something that happens at the high school level,
right,
when you want to find out how many fouls somebody,
right,
has.
Yeah.
But rarely do you see the scorers not know what the score is of a basketball game. Of course, there's been a three-pointer every turn of a head.
Right, so it's plus three, plus three, plus three.
It's hard to track, but that's where we have the delay. Which gives me time to remind our listeners that today's broadcast on 94.7 WDSD is powered by Brandywine Electronics. Visit BEL.com for all your audio needs. They handle just about every event here at the University of Delaware. We're pleased to be working with them this season and all seasons. A great relationship we have with Brandywine Electronics. Visit them at BEL.com. So the score stays at 58-42. A break for Delaware, I guess,
yeah,
because Charleston Southern just minus three.
Home court advantage.
That won't take them away from their percentage, though.
No.
10 of 12. As Pinker will fire away. He can't hit. Quick shot as the shot clock. I don't think the shot clock went down, actually,
no,
at all on that one. They're having some trouble over the scorer's table, but it was showing 35 when he hit it. Obviously, not at 35, but an early shot in the shot clock there for Pinker. Probably not the one he wants to take as a freshman. But Delaware down 58-42, under 2 minutes left in the first. And Strickland with it on the wing. Harper wide open. How can you do that? He misses, though. Maybe too open. Back tapped on the offensive rebound for Charleston Southern. With a team shooting 10 of now 13 from three, how do you let a three-point shooter have 5 feet of room?
Yeah, it just shouldn't happen. That's
There's
a defensive
Strickland
collapse.
With room now. Two misses and a break for Delaware. Both of them wide open. Bad rotation on the D that time. And Delaware has the basketball. Sadler inside out dribble driving on Strickland. He's bumped at the elbow, pulls up, and it's good. Devon Sadler already in takeover mode. He's got 16 of Delaware's 44. They trail by 14.
Yeah, it's important here that Sadler does not pick up his third foul with almost under a minute to play here, especially with three already in foul trouble.
Worth mentioning by John because an aggressive take that time by Sadler,
yep,
got some body contact. Saunders up for three. Three misses in a row from Charleston Southern. I'm amazed right now.
Yeah.
That they missed three in a row after starting 10 of 12 in the contest. 58-44 is the count. Delaware can go 2-for-1. If they get a basket and a stop, the damage won't be as bad in a locker room. A lot of basketball left after the break. Sadler with it on top. Crossover on Strickland. Making Strickland dance over to Pinkard for three. Boom! The freshman off the dish from Devon. And Delaware within 11 now after being down by 20.
Well, I was going to say, when Pinkard took his last three-pointer and missed it, it looked like it was flatter than usual. And that one had a nice arc on it and hit nothing but net. And so that was a nice hit by Pinkard, not only obviously for the 3 points, but it'll give that kid a lot of confidence.
Shot clock turned off. 10 to play in the first half. Nimbley going to try another three. It's off the mark. And the ball saved for Charleston Southern. Strickland inside at the buzzer gets it through. 60-47 is the count, taking in to the locker room. Charleston Southern comes into the Bob, starts 10 of 12 from three, finishes 10 of 16. What an amazing start for the Bucs, but a lot of basketball left for Delaware to adjust in the second half and still come away with a victory. For now, though, we're going to take a timeout, sent to the Blue Hens halftime report. When we come back, we'll hear from Dave Hovel, who's back in the WDSD studios. We'll have scores and a Blue Hens sports report from a busy weekend in Newark. Back in a moment with Charleston Southern up 60-40.
and welcome to the 2013-2014 Blue Hen Beat Basketball Special. I'm Kelsey Buchanan.
And I'm Carl Baptiste. In today's show, Scott Klatskin will sit down with Monte Ross to preview a little bit about our season and learn about the 3Ds on the men's team.
We also tell the story of senior guard Akima Richards, who was born in the U.S. Virgin Islands. Scott will be back later in the show with the Blue Hen Sports Update, and we have some fun with other CAA coaches at Media Day.
But first, Jimmy catches up with Coach Martin to preview the women's season.
Thanks, guys. Jimmy Smith here with head coach Tina Martin. And Coach, getting ready for the 2013-14 season. And Coach, obviously 2012-13 was something you want to hang your hat on. It really brought women's basketball here at the University of Delaware to the forefront. And I know you don't want to compare last year's team to this year's team. You want to move forward. But in terms of program exposure, in terms of getting our name out there, maybe making recruiting easier and exposing this great university to the country, how important was that to you?
Well, the year itself was very important. You know, recruiting is never easy. I don't care if you win a national championship, it's never easy. Bottom line is that we had a great year. The fans enjoyed it tremendously. Mm-hmm. Once it was done, I enjoyed it. It's pretty stressful going through it. But I thought the coaches did a great job of preparing our team, and the kids obviously were really, really into it, and it was just a once-in-a-lifetime experience. So one for the ages, as they say, very historical. But this group is very different and very young, and so we've had our challenges already. It's been a little bit of a roller coaster ride. Some days we play very well, and then other days we're not doing so well. So it's an adjustment for sure. And to go from one extreme where you have seven seniors and they know exactly what you want them to do, to having a group that is very unsure of themselves and really unsure of just the system, it's like night and day, really.
All right, Coach, three of those players are your tri-captain, Stephanie Leon, Kelsey Buchanan, and Akima Richards. Those are the gals that got some of that time last year under your six seniors. How important are they to this team? They obviously, as they go, will probably go.
Yeah, you know, the three tri-captains have the most experience, and they do understand what I want. And, you know, they're not very verbal from the standpoint of they're quiet kids, really good kids, but they've had to step out of their comfort zone a little bit. So they're huge in just relaying the message and preaching the message and then carrying out the message.
The players, sometimes you forget when you're in a transitional phase like this, is you got your seniors, we talked about them, then you want to talk about your newcomers, but let's not forget about the players that played last year as freshmen, the Jade Clarks and the Courtney Greens and the Alicia Bells, but then also the players that redshirted, Jody Salyer and the transfer in Joy Caracciolo. Talk about that group in there, because they're obviously going to take the roles of the Akimas and the Stephs and the Kelseys from last year. They're going to come in more of an auxiliary role.
Yeah, you know, the sophomore class is a solid class. They need to step up, and even though they got limited minutes last year, they had some opportunities, and I think they're excited to show what they can do.
And then your freshman class, obviously some prize recruits in there, turning the page, turning the corner, and getting some of those bigger recruits. Everybody's not going to be an Elena Deladon type of recruit or land for you. But now you're getting consistency. You're up in the top 150 and getting some big players and doing on a consistent level. Talk about some of the names that we'll hear this year from the young pups.
Yeah, you know, I call them my babies, if you will, but, you know, diaper dandies, whatever you want to call them. The other big thing for us, for the freshmen anyway, Jody being a redshirt freshman, is taking care of the basketball. I mean, those three kids are going to play a lot. They have a chance to play a lot, and so they need to just take care of the ball, not turn it over, and do a good job overall, you know, really helping us.
And, Coach, you mentioned the CAA landscape. It's never changing conference, but this year, you know, JMU is going to have a lot of returners. They did not have the type of senior turnover that we had, so they'll be a great team. Drexel will be a great team. Who are some of the teams that you really think are going to stand out here as you inch closer to basketball?
Well, you know, certainly in our league, as you mentioned, JMU, I mean, they've got everybody back, and with Nikki Newman coming back, the defensive player of the year, she was out with a stress fracture, got hurt early part last year. I just think that makes them the veteran favorite, and we've got to be able to play some good, solid Delaware defense, and that's the thing I've said mostly to our team is that we've got to defend. This young group, you know, the biggest thing they don't understand is the physicality of college basketball and the speed with which the game is played. The majority of them are coming from the high school level, and they just are not used to that speed and that physicality. So that'll take some adjustment. And I think in the non-conference portion, playing the teams that we're playing, like a Wake Forest, like a St. John's, like a Temple, like a Princeton, that's going to get us ready for sure. But it might be a bumpy ride at first, and our fans have to accept that and understand that and have patience. patience.
And Coach, you just talked about the fans, and we'll give Monte a chance when he sits down with Scott later on in the show to address the fans in the same way, and I want you to take a time to say to the fans how much they meant to you last year, how important they'll be this year, and kind of your final message as we get closer to November 12th.
Well, I mean, the fans they're everything to us, and they've been our sixth man for the 17 years I've been here. Certainly last year was memorable in so many ways, just having them there, energizing the team, bringing their enthusiasm, bringing that excitement that is Delaware basketball. So I just want the fans to come out and really get behind this young group and support them as much as you possibly can, because really you are our backbone. You are the people that help us, and the enthusiasm that's generated in this gym helps us win ball games. So come out, support, and we love you.
Well, you heard it there from head coach Tina Martin. They kick things off here in the Bob Carpenter Center November 12th against, can we call them a rival?
Yeah.
We'll call them a rival. The Temple Owls here at 7 o'clock on November 12th. Thanks, Coach, and good
luck
this year.
Thanks a lot.
That's head coach Tina Martin. We'll be back with more Blue Hens Beat.
I'm very excited to hit the court with this next girl. She originally moved here from the U.S. Virgin Islands at a young age after her family home was hit by a hurricane. She's a senior leader as well as a co-tri captain on our team, and she's also my best friend and teammate. Here's a little bit more about senior guard Akima Richard.
Moving from the Virgin Islands here was a big transition because I do remember that a really bad hurricane. I can't remember the name of the hurricane. Just sweeped through the St. Thomas, and it kind of wrecked our homes. So for a while, we were living with my aunts and my grandmother. Going through that experience, I guess it just made our family closer.
1995, we left after Hurricane Marilyn. School was out for quite a while, and I said, you know, this doesn't make sense. So my brother told me, he lived here for 12 years, and he asked me to, you know, he said, why don't you just try it? We did, and we never went back.
Akima's international experience really helped her. Having the opportunity to play overseas, play against older players, play in a tournament setting in the summertime is a huge benefit to any player, whether they're playing for USA basketball, whether they're playing for the Virgin Islands, whatever. I encouraged her to do that, and you know, her coaches told me she did a great job, and certainly she's a more mature player coming back, and she does know that she has to step up. So I think that whole experience, playing the point guard spot, having to lead another team, certainly hopefully will help her this coming season.
Playing down there and playing for the Virgin Islands was a big deal for me because I had a lot of like fans back there. Like my family, my aunts were like calling me and stuff. Like they were keeping up with the games, letting me know like what I should do.
She's been here more than she's been in the Virgin Islands, but it was a, you know, an honor for her to play for the Virgin Islands because not much kids get a chance or opportunity to do that, you know, and for her to go and play against different cultures and stuff like that, I think that was a great opportunity for her. I just told her, I said, whenever you go out there, just play smart, play hard, and have a lot of fun, you know, very excited.
You know me, I'm very, like, passionate, emotional person. You see it when I play. I just need to always have a game face on so they know that I'm okay. Therefore, when everything goes bad, they know that it will be okay.
The first thing she's got to do is keep everybody calm, which again, knowing her personality is probably not going to be the easiest thing for her because she does play with so much emotion inside. She's got to score some points. She's got to be a vocal leader. And, you know, that's a big change for her. And she's wearing many, many hats, as I'd like to say. But I think Kima being a senior, she'll take that challenge on and hopefully do a good job for us.
It's going to be the same as last year. As a team goal, we always want to win the championship. We want to win the CA championship and at least make it to the tournament, play a game or so. And another goal I have for myself is just being a team leader. We have a lot of young players on the team, and I just have to like guide them because that's just going to be my role right now.
Kima's the type of young lady that is very, very, very feisty. She's really a hard-nosed kind of kid, emotional. She wears her emotions on her sleeve. I love the energy she brings to the team. She'll be the first one to get the team pumped up and show emotion on a good play, and sometimes even on a bad play, and I have to calm her down a little bit.
You know, Caribbean people are feisty. Like, don't get in a Caribbean person's face because they'll bark back at you. My heart and my passion and my love for the game, that's about what my heritage is and my background.
And welcome to CAA Basketball Media Day here from the Renaissance Harbor Place in Baltimore, Maryland. I'm Jimmy Smith. We went around, we asked some of the coaches some fun questions. They're always asked about their teams and their preseason rankings, but we asked them, do they know the origin of the Blue Hen mascot?
I do not, but I tell you what, the first time I asked that question was about 25 years ago because my two final choices in college was Delaware and James Madison. Yeah. And I always wondered when the coach came in and he said, I'm with Delaware Blue Hens, I'm like, what is a Blue Hen? And I never got that answer, so I don't know what a Blue Hen is.
You know, I'm going to say that there was a hen, a Blue Hen, and some fraternity guy dunked, you know, drowned him in some paint, and some blue paint, and threw him out there, and there was the Blue Hen.
Your colors are blue, and Delaware got a lot of farms in it, so I guess that's where you get Blue Hen from.
Well, the state of Delaware is known for chickens, so I guess a hen is larger than a chicken, so they want it to be big.
Maybe it's a hen that's not feeling well.
It's an ill hen. Have you ever seen a blue hen?
I have seen a blue hen. I actually have one, a stuffed blue hen on my desk at work.
Yeah. Do you still have it?
Yeah, I still have it. It's got a little UD football helmet on. It's pretty cool.
Fantastic.
Yeah, it's awesome.
No, I've never seen a blue hen.
I have not.
You have not seen a blue hen?
You ever parked the car in the driveway and drive the car in the parkway?
I've never done that either. Right. So it sounds like we're square. Do you think you know the noise that they make?
No, I don't.
Well, it's like it's a chicken.
It's a chicken. Yeah, it's a chicken. So it probably clucks. You know what I mean?
Cluck for me.
Cluck, cluck, cluck. You know, that's how they do it.
Can you share with us what you think the blue hen does?
Quack, 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 quack.
I told you he'd do it. It's like a bawk or a squawk. No.
A bawk. Bawk, bawk, bawk.
We got her to bawk like a chicken on the camera, which is fantastic. We got both Drexel's coaches to sound like chickens before the season even started.
First you get the bread, then you get the cheese. Save the milk for last, all right? You got it? Blue Hens on three. One, two, three, Blue Hens.
This one needs more cheese. Oh yeah, this one looks really good.
Okay, class, what did we learn last time?
When we align in this formation, they're bound to give us cover too.
From the scout report I got, I thought we were doing a box of one.
Tina, what are you doing here?
Okay, Brittany, now work on your 100-meter doggy paddle. Yeah, you know, doggy paddle.
No. Doggy paddle, doggy paddle. What are you doing? Doggy paddle.
Look, this is kind of be the bleachers.
Okay, they can be the bleachers. You go. Hard as you can, as fast as you can. Everybody do a good job. Go! Let's go, let's go, let's go. Come on, come on. Go, Blue Hens!
I think it's the paper. It's a paper jam.
No, your settings. Your settings are all wrong. That's why it's not working. Look, it has to be the settings.
Can't wait for the season to start.
I think it's the paper.
It's got to be the settings.
It's the paper.
Look, it's
it is.
8.5 by 11. It's all.
It's jammed, though. That's what I'm saying. The paper.
It's sports update time here on Blue Hens Beat. First, field hockey, when Michaela Patzner tallied two goals Friday as Delaware secured the first regular season CAA title in program history with a 4-0 victory at Drexel. The Hens followed that up with a decisive 6-1 win versus Villanova to round out the regular season. Delaware opens CAA tournament play as the host when they take on William & Mary at 4 p.m. on Friday. Cross country now, as the Blue Hens were led by a top 10 finish from senior Emily Gispert and placed third overall in the team standings at the 30th annual CAA Cross Country Championships. Delaware will continue action November 15th when the Blue Hens compete at the NCAA Mid-Atlantic Regionals at Lehigh. Football, as the Hens put together one of the most improbable comebacks in Blue Hen football history Saturday night at Towson against the number 7 team in the country. Down by 21 points early in the final quarter, the number 21-ranked Blue Hen scored 15 points in the final 48 seconds, with quarterback Trevor Sasek throwing two touchdown passes as well as a decisive two-point conversion toss to Rob Jones with 19 seconds left to lead Delaware to a 32-31 CAA football upset over number 7 Towson. Delaware will look to keep the momentum alive next week when the Blue Hens return home to Delaware Stadium for the first time since October 12th to host William & Mary at 3 p.m. Sunday now as volleyball fell to UNCW 3-0. Delaware's back home next Sunday to host Towson at 7 p.m. inside of the Bob Carpenter Center. Delaware men's soccer team clinched a spot in the upcoming CAA tournament thanks to a 2-1 overtime win on the road at Hofstra. Delaware finishes the 2013 regular season with a record of 13-4 overall and a 4-3 CAA mark. The Hens will await their fate in the CAA tournament until Wednesday evening. The Blue Hens currently sit in first place with 12 points, but Drexel has 11 points, and William & Mary, UNCW, and Northeastern all sit with 10 points with one game to play each. And finally, Delaware's women's soccer team dropped a heartbreaking match to Northeastern in the CAA quarterfinals. The match ended in a double overtime, nothing-nothing tie that led to a penalty kick shootout. The Huskies outscored the Blue Hens 4-0.
Charleston Southern will get the basketball first, and we are underway here at the Bob for half number two. Up 60-47 are the Bucks with the ball first. Nimley has it as he brings it to the right side. Nimley, leading scorer for Charleston Southern with 14 in the first 20 minutes. Bernard driving baseline on Sadler, playing with two fouls. Kennedy puts it on the floor, driving across from 3-3, hand in the face, but Kennedy shoots over him at the foul line, and it's good for two. The Bucks are up 62-47.
Well, we'll see if they try to go at three and pick up that fourth foul.
Nice entry pass inside of Aptese. He powers up and through. Anderson found him on the assist. Now running the four is Fula. He gets down the left block. Has to pass out, though. Looking for someone to pass out to, I should say. Poked out by Baptiste. Now in the corner. Usher defends Gobbler and a steal for Jarvis Street. It's 2-on-2. He takes it to the rim. Stripped by Nimley as Charleston Southern gets it right back. Quick hands by the point guard Nimley. Nimley takes it to Baptiste, now pulls it back out where Sadler defends with 28 on the shot clock. Nimley now inside, reverse blocked by Baptiste. Get it out of there to the 5'8 point guard. And three pushes.
No, nice job by Baptiste, just reaching out and swatting that one away.
Anderson had a look at a three, instead finds Sadler for an easy two. Another assist for Kyle Anderson. That's two in a row for the junior. And the Hens back within 11.
Nice job by Sadler using the left hand there so that it couldn't get blocked away.
Four assists now for Kyle in the contest, and Fula has a right box for Charleston Southern. Fakes left, forces right, and a good call. Baptiste got contact with Fula with that left arm of Baptiste and upset bench of Delaware, but we had a pretty good angle of it here.
Yeah, it was definitely a good call. You know, everybody thinks if you're playing defense and you got your hands in the air, they can't call a foul, and that's not the case. The offensive player did a nice job ducking into his shoulder underneath his arms, and it was definitely a foul. It was a good call by the ref.
Foul called on Baptiste is his first, and his second team's first in the second half. So it's Ali Fula, 46% free throw shooter a season ago. One of one today from the stripe. Fula from London, England, one of several foreign players on this Charleston Southern team.
Yep, and the coach, I read an article where he said that, you know, this kid is the most improved player from last year to this year. So, you know, they expect big things from him this year.
And that's an improvement from a season where he finished third in the Big South with 1.3 blocks per game. He'll need some improvement from the free throw line, though. Those didn't look good. Two misses for Fula. Break for Delaware. Now Jarvis Reed across half court, met by Nimbley at the three-point line. Usher, a ball fake, frees him up for a three, and Usher knocks down the triple, his second of the afternoon, and the Hens back within single digits. It's 62-58, and Charleston Southern calls a timeout. We'll take a break with them. 62-54, Hens have trailed by as many as 23. Now they are back within eight. We'll take a timeout on WDSD. Do we have a minute here? Thanks. 7-2 run to open up the second half has Delaware trailing by 62-54. They trailed by 22 in the first half, and a timeout taken by Charleston Southern. Now they've got the basketball back. Matt Kennedy in the corner for the Bucs. He brings it left to right. Right block, fades mid-right, and he knocks it down. Matt Kennedy is showing some talent in this basketball game.
Yeah, and he's got three covering him, and there's not a whole lot three can do because he can't pick up a fourth foul this early in the second half.
Sadler has 18 in the basketball. Kyle Anderson on the right side, deep. Nimbly defends. Now three at the elbow right side. Usher made a three last possession. This one's going to be short side of the rim. And Nimbly gets the rebound.
Yeah, it was more force than Monte Ross probably would have liked to.
Jarvis, three with a steal on the other end. Baptiste has three left his feet. Had to find a player. Baptiste the closest man. And out Sadler in the corner for three. That's good. And Delaware within seven.
Oh, I like what they're doing. They're chipping away. They're chipping away, and that's what Coach Rafferty said that they needed to do. They didn't have to come out and go on a 20-0 run. They just got to chip away, play good defense, take good shots on offense, and for the most part, they're doing exactly that.
3 minutes into the second half. Nimbly with a floater after a crossover frees him up. Couple of taps after the miss, and now it's Usher with the basketball. Good defense that time by Delaware. Usher does not have numbers, but will slice through the lane and score. Plus one. Here come the Hens.
Wow, what a move by Usher. I got a little nervous when he came across half court. You could see he was focused on the rim, going one on three basically, but he made such a nice move inside. Charleston Southern really had no option but to foul him, and he made a nice kiss off the glass with his left hand.
Hens within five, 64-59. They trailed in this basketball game 44-22. Now a run led by Davon Usher. He's got 14 points now. The chance for another at the stripe. We'll see a substitution. Baptiste will come out. King Davis, the first off the bench for the Hens, will come in.
Well, Baptiste, I've been very impressed with him on both sides of the floor. He's hustling after everything. He actually tipped that ball, which allowed the break to happen. So Baptiste getting a well-deserved rest.
Usher misses, and MKD battles the rebound, knocks it out of bounds. Last touch by Charleston Southern, and the Hens down by five with a chance to make it a one-possession game on this throw-in.
Yeah, it looked like it rolled off the body of Bowen there, and so a nice call by the ref who had the perfect angle to see it.
Three will throw it in, left side, looking for help, and all the way back court goes to Anderson. Quickly ahead to Usher in the corner. Left side, it's three. Three waves off what could have been a pass inside to King Davis. Usher, no look inside MKD as he goes block to block. And he leaps over the defender, misses. Usher's there to follow. Davon Usher has 16, and the Hens back within a possession at 64-61.
Well, you saw how much he can leap there.
Kennedy to Bowen. Back to Kennedy. He drives on Sadler. Blocking foul on Davon Sadler. He doesn't know what he could do. Trying to get away from the defender. And the whistle called by the referee underneath. Not pleased is Davon Sadler. And probably right not to be pleased. That's his third.
Yeah, I'm not sure. Like you said, Scott, I'm not sure what else he could do there. He was actually running backwards away from the offensive player. And he ran into him. So not a good call, I don't think, on that one.
And ball never lies. A steal by Usher on the inbound. Down he goes, and this time with the right. Can't finish. Rebounded by Harper in traffic. Charleston Southern wants to push. It's Kennedy to the rim. He goes and scoops and scores for two. Back up to five for the Bucs.
Well, a lot of teams in that situation would have held the ball up, but you can see Charleston Southern, they've got no problems. Just sprinting up court. Doesn't matter where they're at in the game or where the momentum is.
4 minutes into the second half. Heads down 66-61. Usher driving into the paint. Hop step foul on the floor against Matt Kennedy. That's the second on the Bucks this half. We'll take a timeout on 94.7 WDSD. 15:50 left to play in the end. Starting the second half on fire. We'll be right back. SummitRx.com. That's SummitRx.com.
Well, Usher's been the spark here. He's got 7 points already in the second half, a total of 16 on the game.
Usher with the basketball now. He and Sadler have 12 of Delaware's 14 second half points. Anderson to the rim. He gets it on the scoring of the Hens. Back within three, 66-63. Good cut by Anderson.
Yeah, he probably could have pulled the trigger for three, but he saw he had the baseline, and nice job by him getting to the basket and a strong layup.
Harper drives past three into Marvin King Davis. The block starts it. Three to cross half court. Over to Usher. The triple for the tie. Off the mark. Back tapped out of bounds. Looking for a whistle, and it'll be Charleston Southern's basketball.
Yeah, they got that one right. Kyle Anderson was trying to give himself the ball there, but it definitely went out on him.
Delaware, some excitement as they battle back. As we mentioned a moment ago, Davon Usher and Devon Sadler, 12 of now Delaware's 16 second half points. They've been able to will Delaware back. 66-63 is the count right now.
Well, and here again, we're going to probably try to see them try to pick up a fourth foul on either three or Sadler.
Harper taking it to the rim, reverses this time, but Marvin King Davis cannot be fooled twice in a row. Another block for MKD. Now it's three. Corner, Usher for the tie, and it's off the mark, tipped out and rebounded by Bowen. Two chances for Delaware to tie the game at 66. They come up 0 for 2 off the left-handed arc of Devon Usher. Now on the other end, a tie-up inside and a foul goes against Delaware. That's the third on the Hens this half.
Well, two shots by Usher. You know, both were open shots. One looked like it came up a little short, the other one a little bit long, and sometimes that's what happens. If you hit one that comes up short, you try to launch a little bit harder the next time. So he's just got to get his rhythm back. You know, he's an excellent three-point shooter. Had a lot of games last year where he had multiple three-point shots in a game. So his rhythm will come.
Free throw missed by Bowen. Charleston Southern not helping themselves from the free throw line in this second half. 19 times, John, Davon Usher had multiple three-pointers in a game. He was 7 of 8 against Northwestern last year. And that's a tough non-conference game for a team playing in the SWAC, for anybody, really, playing a Big Ten squad. And Bowen knocks down the second free throw, lead now 67-63, Charleston Southern.
Well, I like what Delaware's done on offense. They've taken good shots. They haven't panicked yet, and they're working the ball around, making sure that the guy who takes the shot is the one who's open, not just launching it up.
Marvin King Davis over to Sadler. Sadler guarded by Saunders. A couple of crossover dribbles. Now leaning in for two. That was halfway down, bounced out. Tough break for Sadler, and it's Charleston Southern basketball.
Yeah, he'll have a couple shots like that every game.
Now nimbly misses on the three. Harper in position for the rebound. His shot rejected. Help D from Usher goes out of bounds, and it'll be Delaware basketball. Nice job by Usher to help out both Sadler and Jarvis Street, playing with three fouls, knowing they can't leap forward, right. So he does the work.
Well, and it's nice rotation on the defense. We talked about that. We saw a couple times in the first half where the reason they got open threes or open shots is there wasn't any defensive help on the rotation. And there, Usher, you can't do it any better than that.
Three. In front of the Delaware bench, now to Sadler, open for a three, and the Hens 0-3 from triple in the last three possessions. Ball knocked out of bounds, last touch by MKD. It'll be Bucks basketball, and Baptiste will check into the ball game for Marvin King Davis. Usher goes to the bench, but the Hens only have four out there, so he has to come back out.
Yeah, I'm not sure. I don't think he wanted to come out, so I'm sure he was happy to be waved back into the game.
Hens down by four, 67-63. It was 60-47 at the break. Buccaneers on top. They led 44-22 at one point. Now nimbly hanging, tough angle, can't get it. Follows his shot, though. The 5'8 point guard gets an offensive rebound and resets the shot clock for Charleston Southern. Kennedy in the air to Strickland. Extended left elbow jump shot off the mark. And rebounding is Gombor. He was working hard for the O-Reb, and now he is fouled. Good work by the Buccaneers to continue that possession twice on the offensive glass.
Yeah, and that was more a result of, like you said, hard work by the Buccaneers. Kyle Anderson did a great job boxing out. He just got out-muscled by two other guys while he was out boxing out one guy. So you can't fault the Delaware defense there. You know, once in a while you're going to give up an offensive rebound, and you got to credit the offense more than question what you did on defense, and that was the case there.
Second foul by Davon Usher. Team's fourth. Gombor at the stripe. He makes it. Paul Gombor, the 6'6 junior from Nigeria, played his high school ball at Monteverde Academy in Florida. Averaged 5.5 points a game a season ago. Finished eighth in the Big South in offensive rebounds. And Got an offensive rebound there. Misses the second free throw, though. Baptiste with the rebound. And the Hens down by five. Push it to Anderson. He drives on Gomber. Floats it up from the left side. Baseline from five out, and it's good.
That's a tough shot. A lot of people don't realize how tough that seven-footer from the baseline is, especially when you're floating like Anderson did. So a very nice touch by him.
Hens back within a possession, 68-65. Double crossover, Nimbley, pass out Kennedy. Kennedy stopped by three at the elbow, left side, looking to find a guard, does. Nimbley plenty to shoot, 19. Nimbley behind the back, runs into his teammate who was setting a screen for him. Now top of the key with 12 to shoot. Working on Anderson, getting to the rim, and over wow. Two defenders. The 5-8 point gets it through off the window.
Well, that was another case there. You just can't blame the defense. That was just a great move by Nimbley.
Now three, Tux holds in the air, misses, but Baptiste follows, close to offensive goaltending.
Yeah.
But it was coming off, and Baptiste timed his jump perfectly to make it 70-67. It timed that as he bumped right into Nimbley going for a steal. That's a foul on Baptiste. Now he's got three, and that's the fifth on Delaware.
Yeah, a little anxious there. Baptiste popping out to the three-point arc to make a play on a much smaller guard. I'm sure Monte Ross would prefer him to stay underneath on that situation there. But he had the foul to give, so not the end of the world.
12-27 in this one. Delaware trails 70-67. Pinkert will check it, as will Marvin King. David Sadler going to get a well-deserved rest. Carl Baptiste will check out as well.
Well, it'll be interesting to see how long they keep Sadler out. You know, in a normal situation, he would stay out through the media timeout and come back. But with the three fouls, we'll see if they can maybe keep him off the floor a little bit longer and still stay within a few points.
Close to the media timeout at 12:21 left in the second half. Strickland on the freshman. Pinkert pulls up from the elbow, misses, and Usher gets another rebound, pushes ahead to three. Hands in a hurry. Pinkert squares, fires, three is off. Long rebound and a whistle away from the ball. And a foul on the floor. Looks like that's going to go against Charleston. Southern fighting for the rebound underneath, and it's going to be Ali Fula, his second foul, and the team's third.
Well, Pinkert is now 2-for-5 from three-point line, and it looks to me like on his misses, his shot is flatter than when he makes it.
Three on the drive, kick out. Usher, he'll try again from three. Open too strong, double bounce on the rim, and a foul, another foul on a rebound for Ali Fulan. You can credit Marvin King Davis for working hard on the offensive glass.
Yeah, and an extra bounce off the rim. And sometimes when that happens, when you're a defensive player, you realize you're not in the position you were, and you try to get away with something you shouldn't. And that's what happened there. And that was because of King Davis, like you said, Scott, working so hard on the offensive glass. Ross has to be happy with how his team has worked on the offensive glass this game.
Fulan's third, team's fourth of the half. Three inbounds to Pinkert. Pinkert checks back with three. Telling him to bring it out. And Usher not looking. And a lazy pass is thrown away by Harper. Usher, a lot of contact down the floor on the missed layup. And now Charleston Southern cannot convert after three chances at the rim after the turnover. Got away with a foul there. Did Davon Usher down the other end. Fires up a three. And we are tied at 70. Davon Usher didn't give up on the play. Gets the misdirection. The shot on the other end, and then on offense, ties it at 70 with the three. We'll take a timeout with 11:39 left in the second half, knotted at 70 apiece. How is that not a... Avidy Let's get you a quick Glasgow Medical Aid Unit scoreboard update with locations in Glasgow, Christiana, and Middletown. Go to Glasgow Medical Aid Units or visit them online at GlasgowMedicalCenter.com. Some great news for Delaware field hockey as they defeat Northeastern 5-1 and win the CAA Championship. Congratulations to Delaware field hockey this afternoon. Back in action as Bowen gets the ball in the paint, fouled by Marvin King Davis, first on MKD. Good foul.
Yeah, it definitely was. You know, you got the fouls to give at this point, and so you got a tie ball game. You don't want to give up an easy layup. And we mentioned earlier whether Sadler would come back in after the media timeout. He has not, so they're going to try to milk his time on the bench as much as they can with those three fouls. It'll be interesting to see if they stay close like they are right now, if Sadler doesn't come back in and three goes out for a couple minutes. But give both those guys credits. They've done a great job, played good defense, and not picked up their fourth foul.
Bowen's free throw is good, and with Davon Usher, you have a chance to extend rest for Devon Sadler.
Right.
And Jarvis Street to Sadler now will check back into the ballgame.
Yeah, they don't have that luxury last year, you know, and so that's a big impact that he can make. You know, we talked about it's a shame that he's a senior, and so he's only going to get to play here 1 year. But fans who have seen him play tonight certainly have seen every facet of his game, whether it's going behind his back for a layup or blocking a shot.
Bowen makes them both. Bucks retake the lead 72-70. And Usher up to 19 points on the afternoon. 3 of 11 from three-point range, but 8 of 18 from the field. He's the second-leading scorer behind Devon Sadler. 21 points in the day for him.
And Sadler's back in and three'd out, just as I thought might happen.
Pinker over to Usher. Hens down by two. 11-20 left to play from the Bob. Anderson to Sadler. Open for a three. It's a deep one. Hit as he shoots. No whistle. And he misfires. Saunders with a rebound for the Bucks.
Yeah, I'm not sure Sadler got hit. I think he tried to do a little bit of acting there, and the ref didn't go for it.
Nimbley. Foul line jumper right. And misfiring into the hands of Pinkert. Pinkert finds Sadler. Sadler head up across half court. Leads it for Devon. Gets away with a couple of extra steps. And he finds the guard Anderson. Anderson inside. Gliding through the lane. And missing. Usher with a steal though. Nice move by Usher to step in front of a pass. He loses grip. But a whistle as the ball goes out of bounds. It'll be Delaware basketball. Not sure if it was a foul called or out of bounds. And now I believe a foul called on Paul Gombler. That's the fifth on the Bucks and the first on Gombler.
Yeah, he ended up taking Usher's feet out from underneath him, so the refs really had no choice but to make the foul call there. Good hustle by both players. Poor outlet pass by Charlton Southern, and Usher was able to pick it off.
Sadler will be the inbounder. Gets it to Marvin King Davis. Now to Usher on the left side. Brings it to the center of the floor. Reset shot clock after the foul. Sadler driving, held by Kennedy and Saunders. Pick your poison if you're the referee. Believe they're going to go against Matt Kennedy. That would be the second on Kennedy, the senior, and the sixth on Charleston Southern. So now we're seeing the fouls starting to add up a little bit. Both teams went away from 1-1.
Yeah, and, you know, we talked a lot, Scott, about the new foul-checking rule and that thing. I don't think it's impacted this game in particular a whole lot. That foul's going to be called no matter what. And, you know, we've seen a couple that maybe were impacted, but overall it's not as bad as we thought maybe might have happened.
It's Usher on the drive after the inbound. Elbow right, and he connects. Davon Usher, we're starting to see it, John. We're starting to see what made him a top 30 scorer in the nation a season ago.
Yeah, there's a reason to get excited when you see him play. It's good to see.
He ties Devon Sadler for a game-high 21. MKD off his feet trying to help Devon on the baseline, but a nice move by Malcolm Bernard and a foul called against the sophomore from Richmond.
Well, King Davis, you know, that's another good foul, I guess you could call it, because it's going to be a layup if he doesn't make the foul. The good thing I like that he did there is he made sure once he made contact there was no way that the shooter was going to score. That's really important to do, especially at this stage of the game.
Second foul on Marvin King Davis sends Bernard to the free throw line where he makes the first. And Charleston Southern still has not relinquished their lead in this basketball game. They trailed 9-2. That was their largest deficit just in the first 2 minutes of this contest, but went on a run, took a 22-point lead with 6 minutes left in the first. Delaware has battled back, and Baptiste with a rebound after the missed free throw on the second try from Bernard, and Delaware can take their first second half lead on this possession.
Eighth rebound for Baptiste. He leads both teams, and you know, we talked again about how important it was going to be that he hit the glass.
Pinkert kick out. Sadler for the lead off the mark. Long Pinkert offensive rebound. He loses it off of Saunders, who poked it away. It'll stay Delaware basketball.
Yeah, Sadler's lost his touch a little bit. You don't know if that's because of the time he spent on the bench. Remember, this is a kid that's not used to sitting on the bench very long, or if he's a little bit tired.
Baptiste in the corner. Usher Dribble to Pinker. Dribble handoff. Another dribble handoff. There's Sadler. Kennedy is that trouble defending Sadler. Sadler knows it. A crossover. And over to Anderson. Anderson, catch, shoot, three. Around and out. Crashing is Usher. He's got the ball in his grips. Out of bounds off of Gombor. And Delaware will continue to have possession.
That's a great job by Usher getting in and getting his hands on that ball. You know, even if you don't end up getting it, which he end up knocking it off another player, Charleston Southern player, just creating the havoc in there. And, you know, I'm sure Coach Radebaugh is going to tell his team, you got to know where Usher is at all time and get a body on. That's a couple rebounds he's gotten just because nobody's boxed him out.
Sadler to Pinkert. Pinkert a ball fake. He'll lean into one from 15. Missing. Ball loose. Nimbly comes away. Does not have numbers, but that doesn't stop him from rushing down the floor to the rim, gliding through and scoring using the right. Nimbly. So nimble on the way he got to the rim. 18 points for him, leading Charleston Southern. Now Jarvis three. Cross-court pass to Usher. Catch, shoot, three. And wow. Delaware ties it up again at 75.
Well, again, you know, we can't say it enough about this kid, Usher. After starting with 10 points, a double-double in his first game against Richmond, he's now got 24 points, 6 rebounds. He is just on fire for the Blue Hens.
11th time in his career, he's gone over the 20-point mark. He's got 24. Now Bernard a three. An air ball as Pinker got a hand in the face. Tied at 75. Delaware looking for their first second half lead. Sadler to the rim. He's fouled and he gets the ball through the rim. Devon Sadler gives Delaware their second half lead that they were looking for.
Well, and he went in strong on the left and he hung up just a minute because as a right-handed guard going in on the left, he almost had a shot blocked, but because he double-clutched it, he was able to get it away, create the contact, and you saw that big smile we've seen a couple times tonight.
Foul called on Gomber. Sadler a chance for a three-point play here. And he knocks it down. Hens up by three, 78-75.
Hens are playing better on every facet of the game compared to the first half. They're getting back on defense. They're getting good shots on offense. And they've been able to shut down the Charleston Southern three-pointers, or at least certainly not have them make as many as they did in the first half.
Nimbley gets away with an offensive foul, pushing off Jarvis three, knocks down the jumper from 15. Delaware's lead is one, 78-77. Sadler trying to change that. Strong on the three. Pinkert an offensive rebound. And Delaware working the glass again.
Yeah, nice job by Pinkney. You know, Rafferty talked to us at the half about how they were maybe going to send a couple guys back on defense rather than crashing the boards to prevent the transition, but they've still managed to grab a few offensive rebounds here in the second half.
Usher, no look. Corner to Pinkert. He drives on Kennedy. Pinkert loses footing and turns it over. Nimbley with the steal. It's two on two. Nimbley changing directions. Corner, Strickland, three. That's going to be short off the side of the backboard. And Jarvis, three, gets the rebound.
Nice job by three, slowing it down here. Pinkert on that last possession, a freshman mistake, got himself caught in the air with nowhere to go.
Under eight to go in this close contest, and a foul called by Strickland is the eighth on the Bucks. So Jarvis three will have a 1-1 when we come back. 7:55 left to play. Delaware leads it 78-77. Back to get it within 13 at the break. It has been all Hens in the second half, although Charleston Southern still battling, down by one, 78-77. But Devon Usher with 24 points and 15 of them coming in the first 12 minutes of this frame.
Yeah, and what a home opener for him. You know, anybody who follows Blue Hen basketball has been reading about him. There's been a lot of talk about him, and you know what a great player he is, what a good scorer he is, and you know we've heard somewhat, you know, about how he gives a lot else to the basketball team, not only being a great teammate, but he can rebound and do some other things, and we've seen just about every facet of his game here tonight.
Jarvis Reed at the stripe as we come back. Makes a free throw. He's perfect from the line today. Gives Delaware a two-point advantage.
And at this point, both Threet and Sadler can start playing a little bit tougher defense. You know, now that we're under 8 minutes left in the game, a fourth foul wouldn't have been as disastrous as it would have been earlier on.
You're right. They've been playing with three fouls for quite some time now. Threet makes them both. Hands up by three. 80-77. Emily trying to do it all himself. Gets caught. Good defense by Anderson. He passes out to Strickland. Strickland to Harper. Harper lobs it for his man Fula underneath, and a foul at the basket. Fula will have a 1-on-1, as that is the eighth foul against Delaware.
Yeah, Harper went over to Fula and gave him the old, that was going to be an alley-oop thing, but the ball hit the rim, so I don't know what Harper expected Fula to do. I thought Fula actually did a nice job grabbing it off the rim when he did and picking up the foul, because it clearly was supposed to be an alley-oop, but ended up hitting the rim before it got to Fula.
Keep an eye on fouls, though, because still plenty of basketball left as Fula misses his first try. Three fouls for four of Delaware's starters. As Usher picks up his third, Threet Sadler, we've talked about, and Carl Baptiste playing with three as well. Starters in the game, those four I just mentioned, plus Kyle Anderson, as Fula makes the second free throw and makes the score 80-78, Delaware on top.
Funny spin, Fula's a lefty, and he gives it almost a twist at the end of his foul shot. It doesn't rotate like a normal foul shot does.
Maybe that's why he's 2 of 5 from the stripe. Baptiste to Usher, Delaware on offense. Couple dribbles for Usher, looking for Anderson, top of the key. Usher gets it back. Slow pass, lobbed by Anderson. Anderson was off of Usher, reaching for it. That was not a good decision by Kyle Anderson. Not a whole lot of emphasis on the pass there.
Yeah, no, and that's second, what I call a bad turnover he's had in this half. It's got to be a little bit zip. It's probably, like you said, not even a pass that should have been thrown at this point. You know, you don't throw into the corner over a defense like that.
So turnover for Delaware. Only the eighth of the game, though, for the Hens, as Saunders gets inside off the window too strong, and Kyle Anderson going to be called for the foul. That's a two-shot foul for Will Saunders.
Well, and just as we were talking about the, you know, the new rule not impacting the game so much, I think the foul against Threet maybe isn't called without the new hand-checking rule. That one's a lot closer. That was maybe a more of a legitimate foul we just saw here against Saunders. But still, sometimes late in the game, you don't see that foul called.
Saunders, first visit to the line, and he makes the first. Saunders from London, England, College of Central Florida Junior College, helped lead that team to a Junior College Division I National Championship before coming over here. This is his first year at Charleston Southern.
And Radebaugh talked about how much that experience is going to bring to this Charleston team.
Makes both. We're tied again at 80 as Jarvis Threet gets it across, under 7 to play at the Bob Carpenter Center. Sadler with 24, has the basketball now. Over to Anderson, starters in the game for Delaware. Four guards, Threet with a touch, outside right. Plenty on the shot clock, 17 to shoot for Delaware. And it's Anderson, good defense by Charleston Southern. Anderson over to Threet, Threet fires up a three off the side of the backboard. And a bad miss leads to a rebound for Charleston Southern.
Well, until the miss there, I liked what they had done. They milked a little bit out of the shot clock and gave him a wide open three. Just not a good shot by Threet.
Threet. 0-for-2 from three-point distance as Nimbley gets inside, falling down, puts the shot up, and Usher grabs the rebound, his seventh, ahead to Threet. Threet body contact and a blocking, a charge is going to be called against Jarvis Threet, who had his eyes at the rim. And a bang-bang play went up against Jarvis Threet. Now that's 4. I'm a junior from Richmond.
Well, and I think Ross would have liked to have seen him dish off to Sadler. He had Sadler coming on the wing where Sadler could have either pulled up for an easy jump shot or driven to the basket. So a bad decision there by Threet for a couple reasons. Didn't have the numbers, had a wide open man on the side, and also picked up his fourth foul.
Now Jarvis will head to the bench. Devon Pinkert will come in. Great minutes from the freshman from Lancaster. 6 points, 4 rebounds. On 2 of 5 from three.
Yeah, and you love seeing him get these minutes before the CAA season starts after the holidays. It's just, you know, anytime he is in the game, it's a plus for Delaware.
80 80 is the count. Harper trying to give Charleston Southern the lead back. Gets it to Saunders. Saunders lets a three fly. Long rebound to the hands of Fulak. Kick out to Harper for a three. And a second chance opportunity leads to a lead for Charleston Southern.
Well, we've been, you know, the Hens have been fortunate that they haven't been on fire. Charleston Southern hasn't with the threes here. And it's going to be important they continue to play good defense when they're on the perimeter so they can't develop a rhythm like they did during that first half.
Inside, Baptiste powers over Kennedy. And the dunk for the big man. He's got 12 in the Hens, down just one.
Well, rotation there that didn't happen put Baptiste on a much smaller Kennedy and an easy dunk for Baptiste.
5:26 remaining. Strickland working on Pinkard. Pinkard cannot stay with him, and Strickland to the rim gets the basket to fall.
Yeah, and a nice job by Baptiste there, not creating the foul. He's got three and can't afford to pick up a fourth because as much depth as Delaware has in the backcourt, they do not in the paint.
Sadler in the corner, Usher. One dribble, gets a man in the air, looking for contact, gets it, and three free throws coming up for Davon Usher. That is a smart play from a veteran.
Well, and a tough play because he's a lefty, and the defender was on his right shoulder, so he really had to readjust his body to make sure that there was enough contact that the referee made the call. So a very nice job by Davon Usher to get to the line, trying to come up with his 25th and 26 points.
Usher's second trip today, 0 of 1 for the free throw line, makes the first. Davon Usher. Double figures in 25 of 28 games last season. Double figures in both games today, or this season, I should say, as he's got 26 today. He'll get a third free throw as he was fouled in the act of shooting a triple. Charleston Southern made their first three-pointer of the second half after missing 9 in a row. Last possession, and Usher gets three right back. We're tied again at 85.
Well, we haven't seen the Hens go to the free throw line very much today, only 9 times. We thought it would be a lot more than that, but if it is, they're going to have to make their shots.
Strickland makes his a triple again for the Buccaneers. Back-to-back threes has them up 8, 88-85, and Anderson's shot misfires. Baptiste gets the rebound, but he's stripped by Harper. Harper wants to run, does not have numbers, gets to the rim, floats it up, back iron on Kine, but a rebound by Cedric Bowen, and a putback makes the lead 5 now for the Buccaneers.
Well, it's one of the few times the Hens haven't gotten back in transition there, and you can see Charleston Southern got the easy layup. Baptiste can't put the ball on the floor when he gets that ball on the other side.
Sadler held, ball or foul called on the floor as he got the layup to go, but they will not give him the continuation, and he was ripped up on his way to the rim. He will, though, go to the free throw line for 2 shots as Charleston Southern in the double bonus. Arlen Harper called for his second.
All right, nice job by Sadler there. Anderson hasn't been able to get his rhythm going here in the second half. You know, I like that he continues to shoot. That's the only way he's going to come out of it, but at some point he's going to have to make one or dish off to somebody else.
Sadler had 16 points in half number one, 24 now, and he can add to it from the stripe. Does so. That ball spun on the rim around and down. It hung for dear life before falling through the net.
The good shooters get those rolls, and I'm sure he's had plenty of them roll out over the years. He's probably glad to see that one drop back down.
90-86 is the count. This second half has gone back and forth, and Sadler misses on the second, so miscue at the free throw line. Sadler now 2 of 3 in the contest from the stripe.
Nimley looks like they're going to run a set play here, try to get a good shot off.
90-86 is the count. Nimley to Gombert, top of the key. 19 to shoot, back to Nimley. Anderson staying with him. Now Nimley from right to left at the elbow, passes to Strickland. Strickland for another three, that one short, gets the bounce that Charleston Southern needed. And a rebound by Malcolm Bernard. That bounce into his hands gets him to the foul line as he was held on around the rim.
Well, that's a case where the Hen defenders just got caught too far underneath the basket. If you're almost, you know, if you're closer to the baseline than you are to the top of the little arc under there, you end up getting pushed out of the way where you can't even get to the ball. And even if you've got a body on somebody, they're not going to call over the back because they're going straight up to the rim.
Bernard, the lefty at the line, cannot connect, and it remains a 4-point lead for the Bucs. Jarvis Threat going to check back into the ballgame as Kyle Anderson picked up his second, the only starter not in foul trouble, and Pinkard will come out. Marvin King Davis is in the basketball game. He joins Anderson, Threat, Sadler, and Usher.
My guess is we'll see Sadler and Threat in the game the rest of the way until it's either over or they foul out. Nice job by them staying out of foul trouble.
Bernard makes the second, 91-86. Delaware trails. They've led once in this second half. Down by 13 at the break. Usher at the elbow, left side. Backs it out to three-point land where he fires away and hits 30 for Davon Usher in his debut at the Bob.
Yeah, I'm not sure that's exactly the shot Monte Ross wanted him to take, but he certainly wanted it after it went through the net. A nice job, nice shot by Usher coming through in the clutch.
91-89, Delaware trails by two. Gombler driving, kick out nimbly, 20 on the shot clock, working on Anderson. Nimbly, right to left, draws the foul. Good acting job by Nimbly.
Yep. Is
minimal contact from Marvin King Davis, but he flailed his arms to the 5'8 point guard, got the call, and that'll send us to a timeout. Our final media timeout with 3:25 remaining. Delaware trails by two, 91-89. Center Charleston Southern up by two, but what a debut for the transfer from Mississippi Valley State. 30 points for Davon Usher.
Well, you know, Davon Usher said he didn't come here to score. He came here to win games, but what we've seen tonight is he's probably going to have to do some scoring for the Blue Hens to win games. And what I like most about what Usher's done,
with the basketball, 93-89 lead for the Bucks. At the top of the key, to the right side, it's Bernard, hesitates, dribble across the lane, he goes, and a steal. Sadler tipped it away, Anderson grabbed it, Usher pull up, triple, around and out, Bernard grabs the board, no rebounders in the lane after the quick shot by the transfer.
Yeah, I'm not crazy about that shot. I think I would have liked to have seen him pull it out, and even if he ends up taking a three-pointer, get everybody set up, maybe get some help underneath for the rebound. But when you've got your momentum going, sometimes you get a little carried away.
Now 5 of 14 is Usher from three-point range after that miss. The timeout taken on the floor by Barclay Radenball. Full timeout for Charleston Southern. We'll stay right here. A little Glasgow Medical Aid Unit scoreboard update with locations in Glasgow, Christiana, and Middletown. Visit Glasgow Medical Aid Units for non-life-threatening injuries, or visit them online at glasgowmedicalcenter.com. Some games that were final from earlier in the day around the CAA. Northeastern fell to Boston. That game was played at the TD Garden, home of the Boston Celtics. 72-69, the final in that one. Boston wins it. Iowa State beats UNCW 95-62. That one final. Then in 15 minutes, Hofstra will tip off against Fairleigh Dickinson. That game, a home game for the Hofstra Pride at 4.
Fairleigh Dickinson, where my father went to dental school.
There you go.
Small school up in New Jersey.
They'll be rooting for Hofstra to take a loss. 93-89. These teams will meet again this season. A home and home deal in season for the Delaware Blue Hens and Charleston Southern. The game December 3rd, actually not too far down the road.
Yeah,
December 3rd, the Hens will head to Charleston to take on this Buccaneers squad again. The Hens hoping they'll come down to Charleston with a game up in the season series.
Maybe they'll light it up down there from three like the Bucks have done here against the Hens, or certainly did in the first half. They've cooled off a little, as we thought they might, but you know, they've cooled off and still managed to have a four-point lead with 2:35 to go.
Yeah, the Bucks started 10 of 12. It was 10 of 16 at the break. Just 12 of 23 now in the game from three-point range. But they're finding other ways to score, and
yep, it's
mostly come off the hand of Saad Nibley, who has 22 points on 7 of 17. He's got the basketball and a four-point lead for the Buccaneers. Pass to Kennedy. Kennedy, there's a three on the way off the mark. Long rebound. Anderson scoops it for Delaware.
Well, they got the play they want. They got the shot they wanted, and they got the guy shooting it they wanted. They just weren't able to convert.
Sather with it now. To Davon Usher. Anderson, the corner to three. Three. Corner to Sather. Ball tipped off the leg of Sather. Heady play by Charleston Southern to save it off the leg of a UD player. And Nimbley will bring it up.
Yeah, careless pass there. The Hens got to take better care of the ball at this point in the game.
Under 2 minutes to go. Delaware trailing by four. They trailed by 22 in the first half. Have battled back. Harper trying to extend the Charleston Southern lead. Kennedy from left to right in the middle. Jarvis, three, blocks the shot. Now Sather has it at half court. Three on two Hens at the foul line. Kicks out to Usher. Usher for a three, whistle before the shot. They call an offensive foul on Sather on the pass.
Wow. Certainly the home crowd doesn't like it. Ross doesn't like it either. Sadler's not sure what he did wrong there. It looked like Sather came down and knocked a defender over, and if that's the case, that is not a charge.
The only problem and teachable moment for Devon Sather is that you didn't need to get that close to the defender to find Usher, who was wide open in the corner for the three. He waited a little bit too long to find Usher. That pass could have been made successfully earlier in the fast break.
Yeah, you're absolutely right, Scott. Usually when you once you penetrate past the foul line, you usually go to the basket, and instead he pulled up and allowed the defender to set himself up to give the ref a chance to make the call, right, wrong, or indifferent.
Tough swing for Delaware as they had the turnover and then turn it right back over with the offensive foul called against Sather. He's now has four fouls. He and Jarvis three, both with four. 11 to shoot for Nimbley. A four-point lead for Charleston Southern. Now at six. Top of the key is Nimbley. Step back, deep two. Nimbley hits. And a six-point advantage now for Charleston Southern with 60 seconds to play.
Nothing Kyle Anders can do about that. He can't let him penetrate. And if Nimbley's going to step back and drill it, nothing you can do.
Sather bumped. He'll go to the line to shoot two shots as Arlen Harper could not hang with him.
Well, nice job by Sather. Gets to the line, stops the clock, and at this point, that's what the Hens need to do. They need to score, they need to defend, and they need to do it quickly because they can't allow, you know, they're almost at a point, depending on what Sather does here, where you have to look at fouling intentionally and deciding, all right, who are we going to put on the line? Because it's only a two-possession game, but you can't let Nimbley stand outside and dribble for, you know, the entire shot clock away at this point.
95-89, Sather, first free throw is good. Ends down by five. After the free throw, he'll get another. Both teams with a double bonus. Sather's second free throw is good. With that, he passes Greg Smith on Delaware's all-time charts and is the second leading scorer for UD in the record books.
Hens 11 for 13 from the free throw, so they improved dramatically, which Monte Ross said at the beginning of the game he wanted to see. So a nice job from the free throw line.
Delaware, though, down by four. Still a two-possession game. Nimbley going to dribble around. Jarvis Street is defending Nimbley, but he can't foul. 36 seconds left to play. Now 14 to shoot. Delaware has to get a stop. Down 95-91. Nimbley, a crossover. Driving on three. Usher almost steals it away. Nimbley, he's stuck. Leans in. Shot over Baptiste. Is off the mark. Delaware gets the rebound. Down four. Here comes Sather with 17 left. All the way to the rim. And a reach-in foul called against Justin Harper will send Sather back to the stripe with a chance to make it a one-possession game. Delaware, though, going to have to go for the steal after this, these free throws, and then foul if they don't get it, as the shot clock will be turned off for Charleston Southern. That's the fourth foul on Arlen Harper, sending Sather to the line with a chance for his 28th and 29th points.
Yeah, nice job by Sather making the penetration a three-point. While it gives you 3 points, you're still going to need to score again. So I like how he went in and made sure he got to the free throw line to get the two free throws.
Comical moment in a tense part of the game. Three freshmen ready to check into the game, they all ran onto the floor, and they're not allowed to come in quite yet. As Sadler makes the second, now they can come in after Amante Ross timeout. But three true freshmen not kind of knowing the rules yet. They're all just very excited to get in. But what they're doing by checking in Barnett Harris, Kasmyn Hayes, is Devon Pinkard. One, you're getting some length in the game with Devon Pinkard playing one of those guard sparks. Barnett Harris will be the point man on the full court press, so he'll be defending the ball handler. He's 6'9". We'll see him for the first time tonight, but that was his duty against Richmond on Friday. And then Kasmyn Hayes, basically a foul to give.
Yeah.
He won't be on the floor when Delaware gets the ball back on offense, as plenty of timeouts left for Delaware. They have four timeouts left, so they can, once they get a rebound or possession, stop the clock.
Yeah, they're in good shape as far as that goes. And, you know, given the score at the beginning, at the second half, you've got to be happy for Delaware to be in a position where you're only down by two with 15.4 seconds to go. And so, you know, a lot of things being talked about in that huddle right now. You know, number one, what do we do if they get the ball in? When do we foul? That type of thing. Who do we want to send to the line? You know, you start looking. Nimley's 5 for 5 from the line. Bowen's 3 for 4. You know, but you can't look too hard at that, because the reality of it is you're going to foul probably after the first pass once it's in bounds, because otherwise they're just going to let the clock run out.
15.4 to go. Delaware trailing by two. 95-93. The inbounder is Saunders. Saunders after the make by Sather can run the baseline. Harris will stay with him. Hayes and Anderson are the next in line. Then Pinkard and Usher. Harris waving his arms at Saunders, the inbounder. He can move. Gets it into Strickland. Strickland in traffic. Passes back to Nimley. Now ahead. Charleston Southern finally fouled by Saunders. Saunders was fouled by Pinkard. But 5 seconds come off the clock, and a very good free throw shooter at the line in Saunders, who's 2 of 2 today.
Yeah, nice job by Charlton Southern moving that ball around. You know, and that's, sometimes teams make mistakes, and when they know they're going to get fouled, they hold onto the ball and let the team come and foul them. But Charleston Southern, you can see they're experienced in that. They did a nice job moving the ball around. They, too, didn't really care whose hands it got in. Their key thing there was to keep the clock moving. Fortunately for them, they did get it into Saunders' hands, and as you mentioned, Scott, it's 2 for 2 today.
Saunders bends the knees, fires the first, and misses. The best that Charleston Southern can do is go up three with 10.5 left. And Delaware has three timeouts left, so Monte will draw something up.
Yeah, he's already signaled in that if he makes it, they're going to call a timeout. Not sure what they'll do if they miss. They may go ahead and move it up floor and try to catch Charleston Southern off guard on defense.
Saunders in front of the band, making it tough for Will Saunders, who's missed the first try. Second misses as well. Long rebound in the hands of Jarvis Three. Three pushing. His team down by two. 95-93. Three to the basket. He goes up. No foul. Lots of contact, but no whistle. And Charleston Southern going to steal one at the Bob Carpenter Center.
Wow.
95-93 is the final. Three was attacked at the rim, trying to tie it up. All the contact and no whistle puts Delaware 0-2 to start the season. They fall at home 95-93, back-to-back two-point losses for Delaware to open up the 2013-14 campaign. We'll take a timeout. We come back, the American Spirit postgame show here from the Bob Carpenter Center on 94.7 WBAI.